about me, if you're not familiar. I'm known for talking about the programming of humanity on various levels, not just on the topical level where everybody goes, yeah, I know we're programmed. No, it's really pretty severe. And so for me, the curiosity began, I would say, from the minute I came into the planet, I'm sure before I even got here, but came onto the planet and just had a lot of questions. And I think some of my questions were questions that most people typically do not ask. And my common question was the fact that people died and nobody thought it was weird. I always thought it was very bizarre. So I think over the years, that became like a huge part of trying to understand, was there a flaw here? Was this something that was necessary? And I know a lot of people go, well, what do you mean? You know, we can't have all these people on the planet. Well, that's part of the programming. That's part of the programming is, which we're gonna get into that. But so anyway, so that was a big question for me. And without gurus or guides or anybody, because I didn't even know that anybody else was asking these questions, in 1992, after a divorce, I decided that I needed to really understand more about why my life was, what I had lived for 14 years in that marriage, and just really trying to understand what was this thing that we call life, what was this thing we call reality. And so for me, I decided that I needed to try to understand this without books, and I really didn't want to hear it from anybody. And I just really felt that there was a way to tap into or to break through something. Didn't know what that something was. Not being able to meditate, because coming from a church background, it's all about praying. So for me, it was all trial and error by myself, trying to figure this thing out. And then one day it happened. I had this amazing experience after sitting on the floor in the lotus position day after day, trying to figure this thing out, and it happened. And some of you have probably seen some of this on YouTube where I'm talking about it, but yeah, and then my hands started moving, and I didn't understand it then, but now I understand what happened. I was so consumed with this energy, because I was now, I think, I had moved into this other space that was really beyond the physical world as we know it to be. And it's not that I didn't see the things around me still, that wasn't the case, but I was seeing, the backdrop, I was seeing more of that. And the more I got so excited about it that I was very diligent at doing this every day until I mastered this experience. Ultimately, I started to get information, and it was not channeling like that. Basically, I had realized that information wasn't everything, and that everything had, all codes. So I started to just get information from wherever you want to call it, from everything. And I would write, and I had never taken a physics class before. So so that was real interesting, because the information I was starting to write down about color, light, and sound, and electromagnetic spectrum, I was even familiar with the term quantum physics at the time either. So I was totally raw, just on my own with this, and I'm excited to be able to tell other people that it is our birthright, and it is possible for any and all of us to be able to access any kind of information. Nobody's really keeping anything from us. It really has to do with commitment, desire, dedication to wanting to break through this experience, this illusory experience that we're having. So that's basically what happened for me, and then over time I got very comfortable and trusting of what I was seeing, and then science would, you know, I'd run into pieces of information that would eventually back up, they would support the things that I was talking about. Somebody had asked me recently, had I read Holographic Universe, and I hadn't. And now I understand why I didn't read anything, because I needed to be able to tell people, I needed to be able to say it was possible to do this, and it wasn't a third-party situation for me. I was very clear about that. I just wanted to be able to access information. So that's basically what happened for me. And so now, after 10 years, it was 10 years of complete dedication to doing this day after day after day after day, and then I would write, and then that's how the book, The Holographic Canvas, came about. I wasn't trying to write a book. I was just writing this information, and then eventually I realized, oh, you have a book. And as I decided to put this together as a book, I would get a sense of, you know, go and look this up so that you can use some scientific information to support what you're saying. And that's really how it happened. It wasn't that I went and got these books and I read them, and then I went and I put the book together. No, I got the information, and then I got the supporting information to go with it. And this is how I operate today. I do the same thing. I'll get the information, and now what I get excited about is because I see science coming about and really saying some of the things that would make me seem a little crazy back then, like, you know, the computerized system that, you know, the universe is really like a giant computer. And now we're hearing more of that conversation going on. And human beings, of course, I say we are also a program. Human beings are a program, and that requires probably more explanation, because we get so afraid that we're not going to be that important. You know, if we find out these certain things, it's going to disqualify who we are, and that's not so. To be able to openly acknowledge, recognize, and understand what's possible and what we are can only free us. So my topic originally is breaking the shackles of system-controlled freedom. Now, I think we have to really begin to redefine freedom, because we all have different concepts of what freedom is supposed to be. And when I'm talking about freedom, I'm not talking about freedom from the system. System can't free you. You know, we're running around wanting to fight the system, get freedom from it. No, the freedom, the system can give you the illusion of freedom, and that's basically what we have. What the system does, the things that the system represents or might appear to us as enslavement, are really things that when you open up to a whole other level of understanding, you're able to transcend that. But the system is structured in a way so that we spend our time going outside of ourselves. That's why the system is set up like that. Because you can never come home to yourself. If you come home, if you come in here and you start knowing the truth, then the game doesn't exist anymore in the manner in which it does now. So everything that we deal with is designed to keep you so distracted that you don't really go inside. So everything you want, you look outside. That's why we look to the doctor, and we look to the government, and we look to the healthcare system. Everything is outside. That's what they want you to, it's outside. No, don't go inside, go outside. And that's basically what we're dealing with. So real freedom is really coming from you. And the fear is mastery. The fear is that we will wake up and recognize truly that we are masters and that we really don't have any boundaries. One of the things that I do talk about is, you know, are there any laws? Are there any laws of physics? Is there any such thing? And that was something I realized, is that there really are no laws. There are no laws of physics as we know it to be. Everything that we deal with as laws are based on where we are as a species, where we are as individuals, And we can only understand or access as far as we will allow ourselves to perceive, as far as the latitude of our perception is. So again, the system is structured in a way where your beliefs, your core beliefs, are really cemented into this limited concept. And so when somebody says these certain things, like I'm saying, there really are no laws of physics, some people go, oh, that's just ridiculous. That's just ridiculous. Well, science says, well, no, even scientists know that. We determine what science is ready to show us. We don't realize that. We determine how far science can go, what we're ready for. So let me see here, where do I want to go? There's so many things that I really wanted to be able to talk about. So I touched on the fact that, you know, freedom is just not what we think it is. The other thing is that we have to realize is that we're addicted to reality. We are addicted to our lives. We're absolutely addicted to our lives. Why? Because we're dealing with electrochemical impulses. These chemicals, hormones, form a network or bandwidth that connects us with the core system. There's a core system, obviously, beyond time and space. However, with that system of the system, at times, you know, we short. Let's see. I'm trying to make sure I'm looking at my notes here. I'm trying to make sure I don't go off track, because normally that's what I do. Anyway, so we get very scrambled a lot of times. And so with remaining addicted to the third dimensional reality, we don't realize that we're addicted. So therefore, we don't know that we're not even going within, even when we're doing things to really try to break through and to go within. And that's why we have people say that they have blockages. But I think it's really important that we realize how these chemicals and these hormones that course through us are what holds reality together. That is what holds our reality together. And so therefore, everything that we do in our lives, it's like a drug. We become chemically attached to every single situation. And you look at how you respond when anything changes in your life. You know, it completely throws you off. But we don't think of it as the fact that it is an addiction. And so we are addicted to being human. And I also refer to us as level one humans. What do I mean by level one human beings? Well, level one humans are the level of humanity where we operate from a completely limited capacity. It is as far down as we can go. Now, we don't realize that we have the opportunity to leap from that level one space and go into much more expanded space. Now, what kind of expansion am I talking about? I'm talking about the kind of expansion where, yes, you are moving beyond the whole concept, the whole birth to death concept that we've been given. You're completely moving out of that space. In the level one experience right now, we operate based on the belief of coming into this world, we live, we have these particular experiences, and then we die. And that's what the elites try to figure out, is the idea of immortality. I don't even use the word immortality anymore, because if immortality, if you say you're immortal, well, you don't really know that. You know, if somebody dies, then you know they weren't immortal. So the whole idea is to be able to understand the whole concept of time and all of these things, so you are living fluidly instead. So you're living fluidly as opposed to counting your life. And that's what we do. We're used to applying quantitative values to everything. That's why we count how many years that we have. Now, who is it that decided when people should expire? What do we hear in our world? You know, if you're between the ages of this, and that, automatically when you're 80 or 85 years old, you know, you've peaked. Yeah, and where's that coming from? Where's all of that coming from? And I think those are things that need to be questioned. Now, there's a doctor called Dr. Jenny Lloyd, I believe, and she's even talking about that now. She's even discussing the fact that in 50 to 100 years, that they don't believe that people are actually going to, people are going to be able to choose, they're not going to die. I'm not talking about transhumanism either. Yeah. The body is has an amazing ability, it's an amazing mechanism that when we understand it and the consciousness rises to a certain level, the body really gets turned on. It's not turned on yet, you think it is, but what your body is on is automated right now. So you're running default programs. And those default programs that we're running are the default programs that say, this is how you live. This is you come in here and you die, you know, you're gonna die at some given point. Those are default programs because you're not activated yet. When we become activated, obviously it's because the consciousness has expanded, is more latitude with the consciousness, then that frequency changes the very cellular structure of the body. So there's a whole process that can actually occur. And these are obviously the things that the elite, when we talk about these elite groups of people, these are the things that they don't want your average person to even figure out. They want to save it specifically for them because that's the game. So, and because most people do not ask those certain questions, we're fighting for freedom, we're fighting for a lot of things, we're fighting for healthcare, we're fighting for everything that the system has put in front of us. And so here is the distraction from asking these major questions, because you already have it in your programming that these things are not possible. So why would you even investigate them? Aging it's sold to us. You know, that we must break down, we must fall apart. All of that is just all programming. So that was one of the things that I started to realize, was that our lives are really made up of programs. You know, when you check your life, how much authenticity is really there? That was what I asked myself. How do I know that I like this specific color because I simply like it? I realized that we are walking around and our lives are made up of programs. And even when you think that you are just being so authentic, and the reason why you don't notice it is because when you come in, your parents hand down the same programs to you. And even though you may deviate from some of those programs, educational system prepares you. The religious system prepares you. And those are the parents, the educational system, your religious upbringing. Even when you break away from your religion, you're still encoded with some of that information, because I see lots of people in my workshop that have had a time working through old religious programs. Those things are in there deep. They're like a virus. Not like a virus, they are a virus. And they're in there very deep. So you look at those programs and you go out into the world, and then you've got the social programs, and then you've got the corporate programs, you know, where you work. And so you've got these set of programs that you're traveling in. Now, there's going to be a little bit of edge of uniqueness to it for you. But at the same time, at the core, in your subconscious level, you are operating off of some base programs from which you are making these certain choices. And that's the reason why the system seems to win out, because we are not aware to what level these programs are there. Now, there are a couple of levels that we are operating on. I'm going to talk about the general program, which is the level one human program, the general program, or the general matrix, then I should say, that is there. The general matrix that is there is what a human should be. So there's a program that defines what the human should be, what the human experience should be. And that, of course, again, is a default program. So you're talking, just look at the birth to death program. As long as you still believe that you die, trust me, the programs in there, even with your spirituality and everything in between birth to death, and you still have that program, Yeah, you're still really hooked in, and that is going to be most people. So you've got the general program, which is a general human program, and then you've got, or the general human matrix program. Then you've got the second part of that program, which is the system program, which is a system that runs, or the ringmasters, let's say, which are what I mentioned before. Now, they ensure your interaction, your experience then, the distraction that you will need, and everything that is needed to allow you to continue to operate on that default program, which is the program of limitation. So you have laws, those laws are there to create structure, to create boundaries for us. That's the purpose of that. So if you look at everything in our world in the sense of the governing structure, all governing structures, again, religion, education, the corporate structure, you know, the whole social program, when you look at that, you begin to see that everything does operate with boundaries so that you don't cross over a certain point, a certain field of thought, a certain belief system. Somehow you will always stay in there. So even when you select your own unique religion, you really still kind of don't, you know, because you're caught in this web of limitation. So I think that's something to really understand. So those are the two levels of that matrix system. Now, the two systems exists in a bigger matrix structure, obviously, and we can look at the universe, the universal matrix, okay? There's a universal matrix, and then all the planets are their own unique matrix, their own unique system. Now, the universal matrix that I'm speaking of, that has specific rules, specific conditions to support a specific kind of life, specific kind of experiences. And so the only thing that we're familiar with right now is this particular Earth experience, because everything else for us is really speculation about all the other planets, whether there's life or not life. There's life on all of them. It's just a different form of life. It could be just sound, air, it could be, you know, whatever. Again, that's all part of our programming. We look for everything to look like us or to look like something familiar because of our library of acceptabilities. That we deal with. So you're looking at the bigger matrix, the bigger universal matrix program. Now, I look at that as a computerized system. Why do I look at it that way? I look at it that way because everything is running off of cycles. Now, that's something that we really don't think about either. It's just an automatic thing for us that we're looking at. These are cycles. Okay? Well, a cycle, in order for it to cycle through, it has to be some sort of program. It has to be a program, and it repeats itself. You know, that's why you get your 365 days. Whether it's 362 or 368, it doesn't matter what you complain about. Whether it's the Gregorian calendar or whatever the other calendar was, it's all still a program. And see, we get hung up on these things. Well, no, that's a wrong calculation. No, the fact that you're counting something lets you know that there's a program involved. So the cycle that we live, which is what counts our lives, that's what I was trying to figure out. What is it that knows how to turn me on and shut me off? What shuts us off? What causes us to start puberty? And then when you reach a certain age, it shuts you off, or people expire, like a program, you expire. What is it that's doing that? So I started to look at the overall, the whole system, that it was all this cycle that was happening, and how we were actually networked, just like a computer, we're networked into this bigger program, and it keeps track of everything. It keeps track of us. It keeps track of evolution. Now, why does it keep track of evolution in that manner? Well, it keeps track of it in that manner because, again, that's a default program. It has to keep track of human beings' process and evolution when humans are not awake. Are humans awake? Not really, no. So because of that, which is where astrology also comes in, which is why we look at astrology and we're able to say, this is when you came in, these are the things that, you know, that you could probably be experiencing, or this is what you need to do based on your chart, so on and so forth. All of that is valid to a point. That is only valid for the unawakened human. It's true, because you have to have a navigation system. We have to have something navigating us, because when we are not aware and awake, and that's really what it does. So that's the reason why we say we're heading for a specific evolution right now. We're heading for an evolution in consciousness at this time, after this 104,000 year cycle. We're heading for an evolution, which is true. Because we're not awake, the collective is not awake, because it's able to measure and pick up the vibration and frequency of the collective consciousness to see where that vibration is of collective consciousness, how aware is collective consciousness. Obviously, it's not at a heightened state. So since it's not at this heightened state that would override that program, I hope I'm making sense, that would override that system, then it has to take us on this journey of evolution automatically. But see, we think that that's natural. We think that that's what's supposed to happen. And it is supposed to happen that way. What we do not know is that the individual has the option of evolving without a group. See, we're taught Borg mentality, where we think we need the entire human race, the entire group, to evolve in order for everything to move. No. That is by design. That's part of that program. To get everybody to think in that Borg-like mentality. Because the individual represents the whole. Just like the single cell of a plant, you cut it and you know what? It's got the whole structure of that plant. Well, me, you, each of us represent the whole. So you can make that evolution on your own. Why? Because you're never really going to be truly on your own. You make that evolution and you could potentially then enter into a completely different concept of reality. I know for some people, I don't know, hopefully I'm not going too far out there, but you could potentially enter a completely different concept of reality where, yeah, the people that you're with are more evolved. Now, it doesn't have anything to do with the collective consciousness of the people that were not ready to make that move. The other thing is that we contradict ourselves a lot because we say, well, everybody's here on their own unique journey. We are on their own unique journey, but then at the same time, we want everybody to do the same thing that we're doing. It makes absolutely no sense. Oh, everybody's doing what they need to do. Oh yeah, but if only we could get all of humanity just to come into peace. Well, what does that mean? Because if all of humanity came into this peace that you're talking about, then you couldn't get to chant for peace. See, everything is not a balance. You know, everything has to happen so that we can get to play out whatever that story is. If we need to save the world, we need somebody to save. So we really don't want the peace that we think that we want, because what would we do? You know, so these are things that we say and it sounds really good. Let's change all of that. Well, how do I know they want to be changed? I don't know. So I'm only going to work on me. Now, when I work on me, that could send a ripple. I don't know. But that's the trick. That's something that we really have to understand, that as individuals, you represent the whole. You represent the entire whole. So you need to go ahead and create your own evolution. We never hear of Yeshua or Buddha needing a whole group of people, but oh no, it's different. They are different. No, they weren't any different. Whether we believe the story or not, the fact is that the story exists, so there has to be something to it. There's a story, there's information in there for you. So individually, we need to focus on ourselves. Now you might say, but what about what's going on in the world out there? And that's a whole other game by itself. We have to understand that the things that we see in the news, one of the things I have to always point out to people is that you cannot see the whole world. And I keep saying this because I want people to get this, because we don't think about that. You cannot see the whole world. Somebody paints a picture of what the whole world is for you. You don't realize it because you see it on the news, you see it on the internet, you see it on billboards, you see it on magazines. Somebody has to bring the concept and the idea of what the rest of the world is to you. You have no proof of anything that you're being told. You know what the world looks like for you? Right now, this is the world. Only what we can interact with at that moment, that's the world. That's as much of the world as we know right now. When I was in California, that was the world. That was, you know, whatever, when I went to the store, the Whole Foods, wherever, that was the world for me right then. Whoever I bump into, that's it. Only what I'm interacting with at that moment is the world for me. So I think that's something that's really important that we need to really look at, because what happens when they put the information out there, like especially in the case of this bombing situation and all the series of stories and events, because soon as that will end and there'll be another show. There's always another show around the corner. And these shows are there to keep you distracted. Not only that, they have to get you emotionally involved. You see, because then you, oh my God, this is what happened. Then they bring you into the story, and then that's how you get to experience all of this. Because your emotions get networked into whatever they've got going on. That's why they have to keep feeding it. They have to keep feeding it. Because what does it do? What did I say earlier? It keeps you outside. You're so busy being emotionally involved and caught up in the reality show that they provide that it keeps you outside of yourself. And that's the whole idea, is to keep everybody from going home, from going within. And so when we are emotionally engaged in that manner, it is the perfect moment for interceptions to take place, because you're so wide open and everybody's on the same bandwidth at that moment emotionally. You're in a weakened space because you're too busy, feeling sorry for whatever the case may be. It's easy to intercept frequencies at that moment, concepts, ideas. So it's constantly, we're constantly being fed what the world looks like and how we should respond to the world and all this, all of this other information. So I think that's something we need to look at. Because, again, real freedom is not going to be found out there. What we have to focus on is the science of all of this, because that's what they do. They've studied the science on many things. We're not talking like the mini guys who run things. We're talking the people behind, way, way, way behind the scenes, and then whoever they report to. So they've studied the science of human beings, their brains, how they respond, how to trigger a response from us, how to keep us in a certain field of reality, and we're none the wiser. So for us, we have to then snap out of it for ourselves and start to look beyond that, because we can override those programs, because that's all it is, it's programs. Everything that we look at, everything, and the chair is a program, it's all it is, it's all programs. Everything about life is programmed. Nothing but frequency codes. So we need to understand that, and especially the fact that with quantum physics saying that we cannot observe something without affecting it. Think about that. They get you to observe an experience. And if it wasn't even happening, guess what? You've made it real. That's what they do. They get you to get involved in it, and you as the observer, so you're using your magic without knowing it to create the reality that they want you to create. And they've been doing it over and over and over. And then we end up living in these bubbles. We end up living in these spheres that have been created. In the meantime, over here, they're feeding us information about when we're going to get sick, when we're going to get old, when we're going to die. You know, you get your funeral plot over here, you get your medication here, it's all of that. And it's so sad because, you know, I look on at people, beautiful women, handsome men, and I always thought it was such a travesty. I thought, how wicked that we lose our beauty, our skin, our this or that. And I never felt that that was accurate. I've never felt that that was accurate. And I've always known, even as a child, that this is a program. And I am so happy that scientists, people that they consider credible, are now coming out and saying, you know what? I don't think we have to do this. And I've been saying that because I'm not doing it. So my message is always to bring that. And it's not a matter of, oh, I'm too old. No. Change your perception of all of this. Just dig in and think about what I'm saying. Just think about what I'm saying. And then just on your own, just start to pull yourself out. So start to try to pull yourself out. I'm not saying it's going to be the easiest thing, but try to pull yourself out and pass that on to grandchildren or whatever the case may be. I remember my driving down the street, and my grandson, my older grandson, asked me. He said, and he doesn't even know that I talk about this. And he said, you know, Grandma, he says, you know, I really would like to live past 100. He goes, I really think I could live even longer. I'm thinking, boy, this is in his genes. Yes. No, this is in his genes. And I said to him, I said, honey, you know what? He says, I said, you can live for as long as you want to. And so he said, yeah. He goes, like you, Grandma. He goes, you look, everybody says that. You look really young. I go, that's because I am young. That's because Grandma is young. Grandma is forever young. And I know it can happen, and it's work because you have to break those programs. And believe me, I know because I do. I am diligent with shifting my mind and my focus, because if I'm talking about it, I have to be doing it. I have to be doing it, and it is work. So I'm definitely, I'm not saying it's just woo-woo. No, it is definitely. It is definitely, because they will present themselves. These things will present themselves to you. Why will they present themselves to you? Because when I do workshops, we did a female workshop a few months ago, and you know, I like to be truthful about it. I said the things that we are talking about in terms of evolving beyond, they will present themselves. But what do you do when they present themselves? That's the question. You have to realize that it is real, but it is not real. That it is a program, and that what? The brain, you see with your brain and not with your eyes, because there's really nothing out there. So what you have about yourself and how you look is really just an idea. That's all it is. Because you don't even really exist, but you do. That to me, all of these things, you put them together and you get it. And you really own that, because you realize, well, shoot, if a wave, we're talking a wave and a particle, everything is both a wave and a particle. So that means I am here and I am not. I am appearing and disappearing all the time anyway. You know, so when you start really zoning in and you pay attention, and I start realizing, wait a second, the memory of what you were at 25 or 27, you still exist. Why? Past, present, and future exist simultaneously. Everything that you thought you looked like and were still exists. When I started breaking it all apart, and we do this, this is what we do in the workshop. We put this to work. It's not just me talking. It's you go away, and I want you to work it, because I'm working. I'm in my workshops. So I'm not just facilitating, I am in the workshops. and you start putting it all together, and you say, well, if past, present, and future exist all at the same time, then everything that I want to be, I already am.
Yeah.
In some space, I already am that. So what must I do? I must now begin to see that, and no matter what the mirror tells you, which is what I tell people in my workshop, no matter what the mirror tells you, you have to shift your view of that and shift it into, they get pictures, I say, take out pictures. There's a woman there, she's in her late 70s, I think late 70s. She looks amazing. She's been doing my workshop for about 5 years, but I tell you, you would not know it when you see her. You know why? Because it's not because of what I say. She got it and she owns it. You have to own that. And that goes for everything. I don't care about what they're telling me about this reality with this bomb going on. That, you know what? That has nothing to do with me. It has nothing to do with me. I am seeing a reality that I wish to engage in a more evolved level. The one thing I also want to say before time is up is that when I'm speaking about living forever, living beyond, I am not saying that based on just you want to just live. That's not what it is. We don't live long enough to create the kind of evolution that we need. That's why I'm saying that. We don't live long enough to do that. And just when you start figuring stuff out after like 50 years, you know, 70 years, it's time to go. I'm like, no, I'm just getting down all the stupid stuff I did. I'm just figuring it out. And you're trying to tell me I gotta go? No. And then come back and then do it all over and then your memory's all wiped and everything? No. So I'm like, no, I'm not even doing that. I'm hanging this one out. I am doing this one because guess what? Again, if we are wave and particle and everything is, then guess what? Why is it that we're not talking about dying? Because your body evolves into whatever the next level of reality is. That's why. That's simply it. Molecularly, you shift into whatever that next level is. I don't know if it's 1,000 years from now because it doesn't matter. Time doesn't matter the way we think it does. But you start to get it and your consciousness shifts. It's your consciousness. It's the expansion of your awareness that starts to take you into new levels of reality. See, the only one that we're familiar with is this reality. And so we think this is it. No. The consciousness starts to take you into new levels of reality. So it's not necessarily you suddenly end up there. You are gradually shifting. Now, to me, that's ascension. Not all this other fluffy stuff they're talking about. I'm not into woo-woo. I'm into practical stuff. And it is kick-ass. So I own that. Don't give me woo, just think positive all day long. No, I need to own that I am pissed. And I tell the people in my workshop, you own it and you say, when you feel like you need to go, you know, F it, then you do that. You don't have to be all, I have to think, ooh, positive. No, because you're lying to yourself. Because you don't believe any of what you're saying. And I need to just own how I feel. And some days I want to shirk all of this. They say, oh, we're so glad, and you just, you tell us that's how you feel. Some days I'm like, don't anybody say crap to me about consciousness. You know, and then I feel better. Then I feel good because now I can own that, and then I'm ready to take something new in. Own all of it. It's all wonderful. There's no good or bad with it. We don't have to worry about being a good person or a bad person. All that stuff is just bull crap. When you allow yourself to just be and to expand, you don't have to worry about doing something to somebody else. You know why? Because you'd be too focused on your own evolution. We don't have to worry about somebody doing something to us. Because why? That story is unnecessary in your life. And that's all it is. We bring in these reality experiences for ourselves, these simulations for ourselves. And we live into that reality, whether it be, you know, a little victimization and, you know, or whatever the case may be. And then it's like, I can see us creating this stuff. It's like, yeah, could you supersize the aggravation? Could you, yeah, supersize, you know what? I think I want to have like three really bad relationships. Yeah. And then make the third one really bad because then I'll just, I get it at that point. So we have to look at that and we have to own all our stuff. We can't put it off on the person that we were in a relationship with. It was his fault. Well, you were there for a reason. So I say every relationship works. Every one of them work because they give you just what you need when you needed it right then. And when we start getting those things, life is just so much easier. Because you don't have to worry about that person, you know, well, they shouldn't have done that to me. I have to ask, well, why did I even end up there? So for me, I minimize drama. So because of that, I have like maybe two friends. it's the truth. I wanted to have a birthday party and there was nobody to invite. I have to rent some people. But that was, you know, so we're always laughing. Because my kids are like, why don't you have a party? I'm like, well, I don't have anybody to invite. So, you know, but I rather minimize the drama. I know a lot of people, obviously, but in terms of really good friends, that's a whole different story. But you have to look at your life, and then and tonight go home, and all the people that you were mad at and stuff like that, you know what? Tell them thank you, because that's what I did in the first part of the book. I was grateful to all the people that betrayed me, all the people that, you know, whatever they did. I was so grateful because all of those things led me to this moment where I'm right here, right now, right here, right now. And I am so glad that they did all of what they did. And we start looking at it like that, and we don't have to worry about forgiving other people, and, oh yeah, I forgive her. I didn't have to worry. I'm like, well, you know what? But honestly, what did they really do to me? That's what I started thinking. I was like, well, what did they really do to me? How did this truly affect me? And when you start looking at it, you realize that nothing really happened. Nothing really, you have not lost anything. You really haven't lost anything. You gain something, you gain some understanding, and you take that and you go with it. And there's so much more that I really would love to say. There's so much more that I'd love to say, but I think I have probably about 10 minutes. Let me see, there's something else that I wanted to tell you about. One of the discoveries too that they've made, and I don't have the exact information here, I talked about it in the workshop a couple weeks ago, was the fact that what they realized is that every year we are 98% completely different. You know that our bodies, the whole structure, all the molecules, the atoms, it's not the same. That's really what your birthday is about. That's really what your birthday is about, because every year you are a new person. The reason why you look the way you look or you feel the way you feel is because we're living off of memory. And that's what I figured out. I'm like, oh, we're living off of memory. Because we're real good with that. Why? Because we get addicted to our lives. Whatever it is, we get addicted to it because we are creatures of habit. We are creatures of habit and we don't like to change things. So whatever we think it is, we get hooked into that pattern and we hold on to that. And so to realize that science does say that, this is not made up stuff. Science says that. We are different every year, we change. So whatever it is you're going through is really associated with some sort of memory or emotional blockages. Just so many things that are probably still stored in one's subconscious mind. That's really running the show, because that's where the show is being run from, is the subconscious mind. Subconscious mind has all these programs, and that's what the system, those that run the system, understand that they are doing their jobs. They're doing their jobs. Their job is to make sure you have the vacation of your life here on Earth, because you said, I want to come because that looks really good, and when I come, I want you to give it to me. I want my money's worth. And they give you your money's worth. They give you all of it. And then we get to get together and we get to figure out, well, what are we going to do about the system? And I think it's all so funny, and I think we have to start looking at it like that. We have to laugh. Because it is a magnificent joke that we've played on ourselves. Because ultimately, we are the creators. Other thing I want to make sure I do say is that the system that I'm speaking about, when I talked about the universe as a computerized system, understand that when you say, well, who is running this thing? Understand that you run it. We run it. You know what? Because it will only do according to what? The consciousness. When you, if we soar beyond that, it lets us out. It lets us go because it doesn't have programs for that. It only has programs for structure. That's all it has. It only has programs for structure. So when you move into that fluid space and you understand more about time, that it is really just captured moments per se, and you start to understand more about that, and you take your consciousness begins to expand beyond that, yes, it overrides that program. And that's why when you talk about like yogis being able to make an apple appear, or being able to move from here to there, it's because, guess what? There really is no here nor there. That's why. But because we're addicted and hooked on this reality, this reality is about distance, it's about time, it's about traveling from me, from California to Philadelphia, the experience of that, so we have to have the concept of time involved. And that's all that there is to it. But there's nothing here or there, and that's why we can be anywhere at any time. That's why whatever you want to be is already there. We just have to turn our perception or focus to that, to realize that all of what we want is already there, it does exist, and you begin to work at moving into that space. And it is work, and it's not easy. And buying into these concepts, these woo-woo concepts out there, only serves to, well, their job is really kind of like the ringmasters, the agents that run the system. And I'm sorry, any New Age people in here, but a lot of the New Agey stuff, they're also agents in the sense of the limitations. And I have people that have been part of a lot of those systems, and they're like, oh my God, I'm so glad I'm free now, because there's restriction there. And anything where you recognize that there's some restriction in how you should operate and how you should think, you have to stop and you have to question that. Because ultimately, there are no boundaries. There are no boundaries. And so for me, I do enjoy being here. I was saying to somebody this morning, I don't have that feeling of, I don't feel like I belong here. I know I'm from another time. I am fully aware of that. I am from some future Earth. But I love it here, though. I like the experience. It's very exciting to me. And trust me, if you hear my story, I've had some challenges in my life. But I tell you what, those challenges really made me. It made me strong for the journey, because this is not for the faint of heart. For the journey that I am talking about, where you are on it, and you are riding it, and you are transcending the programs, it is not for the faint of heart. So that toughened me up. Thank you, ex-husband. Anyway. He was my university. But anyway, it made me strong, and it made me determined, and being able to recognize that this is a game. Say that real quickly, four times up as well. I do talk about this as a game concept, and it is a game. And you know why, when somebody says, why do you say it's a game? Well, if you're talking about wave and particle appearing and disappearing, come on now, they're one and the same. And when you observe, it's, you know, we see all this, and when nobody's observing it, it's not. If you're going to tell me that the rest of the system, the rest of the structure of what we define as reality, isn't based on the same concept, all of them against us, it's all a game. It's all one big cosmic game. And it is fascinating, and it allows us to do these conferences, and we all get to come with our piece, and it is fascinating to me, because you get to hear everybody's piece that they're coming with, and I think, God, we get to come here, and we get to do this. You know, we get to speak our thing, and we get to be passionate about it. Now, we can either be talking about, we can invite the system. That's good, too. That's, I mean, you know, it all goes. But I think to really come away and to be able to examine it from that perspective, it will change your life. It will lift a load off of you. Because you realize you don't have to be any particular thing, and you don't have to fight anything, because there's nothing there to fight. They're giving you these concepts and ideas as to what reality is. And if you want to go in and play with that, you can have that. You can go in and play with it. But if you're ready to do something else, then you observe it and you go ahead and you do something else. You make your own evolution. Oh, okay. I have some more time left. Okay. The other thing that I talked about in this last workshop was the heart, DNA, subconscious mind, and the brain, the processing centers of the data exchange, which that was pretty phenomenal, because I basically talked about the heart as a generator, not from the, again, the fluffy standpoint, because I just don't care for much of when you tell me, oh, just love. You know, it's all about love. And it just gets on my nerves. You know, because it is all about love. But you know what? If it's not all about love for you right now, you need to own that mess. Don't say it's all about love when you're not feeling that. When you feel it, because for me, love is allowing. That's how I see love. Love is allowing. It's me allowing you to be and to do and to do. Whatever it is. It's allowing. But it is all about love when we are there and in that space. Own all your hate, all your dislike, own all of it, and then you can change it. Then you can fix it. So with the heart, and I'm saying that because it's important, because since the heart is really a major generator in a way that we just don't even realize, because of its communication with DNA, and then the subconscious mind and the brain, that's why it becomes important. Because it generates whatever it is you really want to have happen, whatever it is you want to project, and I can't really go into that here right now too. The heart is a generator. It generates, it pushes out that energy, the power, moves that forward. And if the heart is not in a space, It's hurt. There's so many things. Anyway, it processes through the heart. That message goes to the DNA, well, subconscious mind, and then subconscious mind gets the message to DNA, and then the brain, and then, you know, the brain takes its message from all of that, and it determines what your body is going to deal with. It determines what the illness is. It will find that weak spot in you, and then the illnesses emerge. Whether it be things that we came in with because it's in our genetic pool or ancestral bloodline, whatever the case may be, finds that weak spot and it attacks that, it emerges, that, because it wants to come up, basically. And that's the reason why naming an illness, I'm not really big on. I just know it's an imbalance, there's something that needs to be taken care of, there's something that wants to happen here. So, me knowing what a disease is called, it just really more causes you to get attached to all of the codes associated with that illness. And that's why when I wrote the article, The Marketing of Breast Cancer, it was really based on the fact that I got so tired of being asked about that pink ribbon. I get so tired, and I wondered what kind of coding we were all receiving, not just women. What kind of coding are we receiving from this information? And basically, we're being programmed to accept breast cancer, like, you know, a common cold, which is why so many people are getting that. Little girls, you know, pink Barbie, you know. So little girls now have the idea that, well, this could happen, you know, one in wherever, however many women will have, you know. And so I looked at that and really did a little bit of research on that, and that's how I started working on the documentary. I planned for it to be just something small, and then it just got bigger. But I wanted people to really look at that and recognize that there was a greater objective here with women, you know, having to have their breasts removed and so on, and what that meant. And it's just really very deep. You get a chance to get on the website, read it. It's the marketing of breast cancer, the pink ribbon agenda, and really take a look at that. And you combine that with everything that I've said here today, and there's so much more. God, I get real out there. This was just mild, but this was really mild, but I get really out there. Another thing real quickly that I'll throw at you. One of the things that I've said to people is, because we're addicted to this idea of reality, we have an idea that this is a singular experience. I know we go, it's all multidimensional, but what we think reality is, and that includes down to our science in terms of even the subatomic particles, what I looked at and I said, wait a second, how do I know that whole idea is only associated with a simulation that we're in, a reality simulation that we're in? Does that make sense? What if there is something that is completely outside the scope of anything that we're talking about? One of the key things, you must keep your mind open, dream and think of the most outrageous thing, because that's what you need. You have to stretch your perception. You cannot say that all things are possible and then you go, only these things. If any and everything is possible, then any and everything is possible. And I keep that in mind, and that really frees me, because I know that reality can be any and everything. So when somebody says, well, I don't, you know, what do you think? Do you think this is possible? Yeah, maybe not in my reality, because I don't want it in my reality, but whatever it is you believe, it's possible and it exists somewhere. It's just a matter of where we put our focus. What's real? Realm of focus. That's what I talked about in my book. Well, how do you find what's real? It is realm of focus. Whatever you focus your attention on, that's what becomes real for you. And then when you use the science of quantum physics as the observer, your realm of focus, you must be what? You must be observing it into existence. And so basically, that is exactly what you're doing. You're observing whatever your reality is into existence based on your belief system. Whatever the belief system is here, whatever your perception is bouncing off your belief system, they're bouncing off each other. And if your perception is only this big, then that's all you're going to get. That's all that you're going to get. So any and everything is possible. And with that, just live big. Just live. Just free yourself and don't lock yourself in a box anymore and go, well, unless science says that this is possible. Science don't know either. That's why every day they're coming, they're just discovering. Well, we're just discovering that we've got, what is it they discovered? I forgot that recently, and in the brain. So they're always discovering something new. So therefore that tells me, I can't wait 100 years for you to figure out what I'm talking about right now. I need to get going with this. Catch up with me later. And that's how it should be. You should figure this stuff out first, and then science follows. Because why? We're all scientists. We're all scientists. We come here onto the planet with lots of information. We have access to everything. We're coded with all of the information. We're integrated into everything. We are everything. We are everything and we are nothing. So when we remember that, then we realize we have access to all of it. And science is only going to respond according to what we are ready for and their own growth. Okay. I don't know, were you guys asking questions before? I don't know. Okay. questions I want to ask? Okay, besides you. No, okay.
Okay, we both have come to the same perceptions and understandings.
Mm-hmm.
I've done it through a very traditional setup way.
Mm-hmm.
How do you describe what you spent those years doing?
Okay. Well, what did I do? Well, when I first started out, I actually would just, it was real simple. I sat on the floor. I just sat on the floor and I waited for something. I don't know what I was waiting for. But I sat there and I would just do this and I would just try to get centered. And the only thing I know is that at some point that centeredness sort of happened. And that's when I just allowed myself, when I started feeling, you know, just whatever it is just flowing through me. So the things that I do are real simple, they're very simple. You don't have to stand on your head at 2 or 8. You know what I mean? That's how I do everything. You don't have to do anything at any set time. You just feel. You feel, and I think more than anything else, desire is so important. Desire, commitment. You have to be committed to wanting to know, because it's that commitment that really causes you to break through whatever that barrier is. And don't have preconceived notions, because I didn't. I didn't know what, you know. So, yeah, if you go, and yes, I know there's meditation, but you don't want to get too restrictive. You want to allow that part of you to come through, because it's always there. We're always online, but we're just distracted from being online. So all that you're doing is you're really lining yourself back up with that expansive part of yourself, is basically all that you're doing. And then when you align with that expansive part of yourself, then the opportunity to really open up, to really just start going places. I mean, I can do it at any given, any moment, anytime, anywhere. That's what I've learned. I don't really sit and meditate like that, but sometimes I do. But what I've learned is that you live there, and you still live your life. I still go, you know, jazz or whatever it is I do, but I embrace it from a whole different perspective. I enjoy the game, people, yet I'm online all the time. And I don't have to be, you know, I don't have to be doing any particular anything. And that's really how it should be. That's really how it should be. And you get to enjoy the game. Important. Disliking the game is your biggest setup. Hating this reality is the biggest setup. And that's the reason why the system is so good at keeping you so pissed off and hating it, because they know that the more you hate the game, the further away you get from the door. But when you get it, you realize, I'll be damned. This is a freaking game.
Well,
no, that's what I was speaking of. When I said the system, I was speaking of the governmental structure and all those things that we are, right, that we consider to be they. We consider those things to be gay, to be they, and when we consider those things to be they, then those things have a hold on us, or so we think anyway. The illusion of them having a hold on us is basically it. And we can say, yeah, no, we don't believe that, but yeah, we do. We're all a little bit infected. And I own when I'm infected. I'm not gonna tell you, oh, I'm not this or not that. No, because I want to know what programs are there. You want to know what programs are there. So, oh, I don't have any fear. No, you want to know what programs are there. Bottom line of it, because that's all you are, is a whole bunch of programs. And you think, when we think that this is who we are, this, you know, this vehicle, but this vehicle is waiting for that part of you to get back in the driver's seat, basically, and drive. That's kind of basically.
I'm wondering, the words, I have two parts. The words, utilizing synchronicity means something to you? And also, in the last few years, ascending, have you noticed?
Oh, by ascending?
Yes.
Oh, thank you. I'm always confused, and anybody who's ever listened to Sovereign Mind Radio will let you know that I never know what day it is. I'm always wrong on the date. in my perception of time, you know, yeah, I would say so. Oh, okay. I would say so. I pay attention, but I don't. You know what I mean? I pay attention to time, but I don't. It's like, I recognize it for the game component. And so I'm not gonna say, well, I don't use time. No, what we're attempting to do is to play in the game and know that we don't have to be in it all the time. But we come in, like we play dress up. You know, we put on our dress up and we're there playing it. And that's how you embrace the experience of it. As opposed to going, oh, you know, saying, oh, I don't watch TV. No, I watch TV. I have shows I watch. There are things I like because I decode everything. And I enjoy everything. So I don't restrict myself like that. I have to enjoy things. That's another thing that we have to go figure out. Otherwise, we end up in just another matrix. We're always in another new little matrix. We're not going to do this because it's bad. Yeah. So we have to examine those things and be fluid. And I think, did you have a second part of the question? Was that it?
The other one was just if you see yourself as utilizing synchronicities.
I think it's just a given across the board. Everything leads to the next thing, you know? It really does. I think when we think things aren't synchronistic, it's like everything is. Because everything, you know, me getting 2 minutes late stopped me from this thing and running into this arena. So it's all on this thing that we're on. So it's not just some things, it's the things we observe. We happen to actually consciously notice. But it's always happening that way. That's it?